A truss is what you see when you look at a truss bridge from one of its sides. A truss is typically made up of a lot of triangles. Now the question is, why triangles? The triangle is the strongest shape. When subjected to force, it evenly distributes the weight without changing their proportions and maintains its shape in position. If you make a square from 4 pieces of cardboard with pinned connection at their joints so that all members can free to rotate, when force is applied, you will find that it doesn't stay square. It can easily be transformed into a parallelogram and collapse when subjected to a little force. Now, if you place one diagonal piece from corner to corner, doing that makes two triangles. Now, this is more strong and stable. Or, if you make a triangle from 3 pieces of cardboard with pinned connection at their joints, when force is applied, you will find that this is more stable and stronger than the square. The reason behind this scenario is, squares are made up of 4 sides, but you can change the angles to get any quadrilateral shape with that same sides. But triangles are different, having 3 sides with valid length, and you can't change the angles to get a new triangle with that same sides, as there is exactly one triangle that you can make from those sides. This is how triangles hold their shape and by interconnecting carry relatively heavy loads in truss bridges. A truss bridge mainly consists of abutment which supports the end of the superstructure, bearing and pedestals which transfers the superstructural loads and movements to the substructure, bottom cord, top cord, end post, vertical, hip vertical, diagonal and deck slab. A single span truss bridge is like a simply supported beam because it carries vertical loads by bending. Bending leads to compression in the top cord, tension in the bottom cord, and either tension or compression in the vertical and diagonal members depending on their orientation. And according to this orientation, over 30 different types of truss bridges are out there, in which some basic types of truss bridges we will discuss today which are most commonly used. Pratt truss includes vertical members and diagonals. Each diagonal member slopes in downward direction toward the middle of the bridge. Gutton Railway Bridge in Australia is an example of Pratt truss bridge. The Howe truss bridge is opposite of the Pratt design, where each diagonal member slopes in the upward direction toward the middle of the bridge. Western Island Swing Bridge in Colombia is an example of Howe truss bridge. Warren truss includes only diagonal members. No vertical members are there. It consists of placing equilateral triangles along its length. Bogibel Bridge and Brahmaputra River in Assam is a great example of Warren truss bridge. Brown truss is the combination of Pratt truss and Howe truss where diagonal members slope in the downward and upward direction toward the middle of the bridge. White's bridge in United States is an example of brown truss bridge. The K-truss is named after K formed back-to-back in each panel by vertical members and two oblique members. Rajamundri Bridge on Godavari River in Andhra Pradesh is an example of K-truss bridge. The Bowstring Truss consists of an arched top cord with vertical and diagonal members running along the span of the bridge. The arch tied with bottom cord looks similar to bowstring, hence the name formed. DMRC Road Overbridge across Chambakra Canal in New Delhi is an example of bowstring truss bridge. And the truss bridges can be classified in 3 types according to the roadbed position. When the roadbed is in the top of the truss, it's called a deck truss or underslung truss. If you look at the cross section of the truss, you can see that both sides are connected and forming box shape. When the roadbed is in the middle or bottom of the truss, it's called a through truss. And here also the truss in both sides are connected and forming box shape. And when the roadbed is in the middle and bottom of the low height truss, which are not connected with each other, it's called as a pony truss or half through truss. There are some assumptions made for the analysis of simple truss. Number 1. All members in truss are connected together by frictionless pinned connection so that all members can free to rotate at joints. Number 2. Truss members are connected together at their ends only, which means loads are only ever applied at their joints of the truss. No loads to be there in the middle of any members. The members will not able to carry bending moments because all joints are pinned. They can only carry axial force. Each member has to be in equilibrium, so the forces acting at each end of the member must be equal and opposite. Each and every member is either in tension or in compression. Now, to determine which members are under tension and which members are in compression, we need to analyze the truss. There are two methods for analysis of a simple truss: method of joints and method of sections. In this video, we will analyze the truss by method of joints. This is a simple truss with some external loads, and there are three steps in method of joints. Number 1. We need to know the equations of equilibrium. Number 2. Draw the free body diagram. And number 3. Calculations. There are three equations of equilibrium in a 2D space. Summation of all the forces in x direction will be 0. Summation of all the forces in y direction will be 0. And summation of all the moments is equals to 0. Now at point A, there's a pin joint you can see. So we will have a x and a y direction at point A and a roller at point D. So we only have a y direction at point D. There are some external loads at point B, C and D. Here we are assuming the forces acting rightward and downward as positive and leftward and upward as negative. You can assume the opposite of it. By summing the forces in x direction, we get minus ax equals to 0 or ax equals to 0. So we are erasing ax from the diagram. Now by summing the moments about point A, we get minus dy into 6 plus 2 into 6 plus 5 into 4 plus 5 into 2 equals to 0 or dy equals to 7 newton. So we are replacing dy as 7 newton in the diagram. Now summing the forces in y direction, we get minus ay plus 5 plus 5 plus 2 minus 7 equals to 0 or ay equals to 5 newton. So we are replacing ay as 5 newton. Now step 2. Let us draw the free body diagram. It's nothing but showing the forces through the members from the joints itself. You can assume all the members of the truss are either in tension or in compression. Here we are assuming that all members are in tension. Wait, what? I said tension, but the force are showing inward direction to the members in the diagram. And we know the force acting outward direction is called as a tensile force, which pulls the members, right? Here most of the students get confused. When we talk about the member being under tension, it actually pulls the joints to elongate itself. It's nothing but the Newton's third law of motion. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. And when we talk about the member being under compression, it actually pulls the joints to squeeze itself. So in method of joints, when we draw the free body diagram, the force in outward direction is compression and inward direction is tension. Now we are assuming all members are in tension. If after calculations we get negative value for any member, that means we guessed wrong. That particular member is actually in compression. Now to decide where to start the analysis, we need to find a joint where there are only two unknown forces. All members are pin jointed, so there are only two equilibrium equations and we can solve only two unknowns. In this diagram, only point A and point D both have two unknowns, so we can start from any of it. Let's start the calculations from point A. Now write the vertical and horizontal components of inclined member AB by simple trigonometric formula. Then apply the equilibrium equations. Summation of Fy equals to 0 or minus AB sin 45 minus 5 equals to 0. By simplifying this, we get AB equals to minus 5 root 2 newton. Means member AB is in compression. Now summation of Fx equals to 0 or AB cos 45 plus AF equals to 0. By simplifying this, we get AF equals to 5 newton. Means member AF is in tension. Now replace these values in the diagram. Now point B has two unknowns. Let's solve it by following same procedure. Write the vertical and horizontal components of AB and simplify it. Then apply the equilibrium equations. Summation of Fy equals to 0 or 5 plus BF plus minus 5 equals to 0 or BF equals to 0 means member BF is a no-force member. Now summation of Fx equals to 0 or BC minus minus 5 equals to 0 or BC equals to minus 5 Newton means member BC is in compression. Now put these values in the diagram. Now you can see point F has two unknowns. Again follow the same procedure. Write the vertical and horizontal components of inclined member CF. Summation of Fy equals to 0 or minus CF sin 45 minus 0 equals to 0 or CF equals to 0 means CF is a no force member. Now summation of Fx equals to 0 or EF plus CF cos 45 minus 5 equals to 0. By simplifying this we get EF equals to 5 Newton means member EF is in tension. Put these values in the diagram. Now point E has two unknowns. Summation of Fy equals to 0 or CE equals to 0 means CE is a no force member. Summation of Fx equals to 0 or DE minus 5 equals to 0 or DE equals to 5 Newton means it's in tension. Now put these values in the diagram. Now you can see point C and point D both have one unknown. Let us solve point D. Write the vertical and horizontal components of CD. We need only one equilibrium equation to solve this. Summation of Fx equals to 0 or minus CD cos 45 minus 5 equals to 0 or CD equals to minus 5 root 2 Newton means it's in compression. Finally, put the value in the diagram. We have completed the analysis of this simple truss. Now you can see which members are under tension and which members are in compression.